Hi, everybody, and very welcome to this Future Food Seminar. I would like to welcome all attendees. We have a growing number of participants still dialing in, but we get ready to start. So we are very excited to do this webinar on the future of food. Actually, it's the third webinar in the series we've organized in the recent weeks. The first one on being future food and health, the second 2 weeks ago on the resilient supply chain, and today the third one is on innovation and digitization in what we call the post-outbreak era. We will look together with you and with a great lineup of speakers in how these two topics can help companies thrive beyond the crisis and accelerate in the future of food. My name is Patrick Schunck. I'm the moderator of today, and let me quickly introduce myself and next the great lineup of speakers for the keynotes for today's webinar. So my name is Patrick Schunck. I'm partner in Deloitte Consulting in and out of the Netherlands. I have a background in technology-enabled transformations and as well as in data and analytics. Consumer industry leader within Deloitte in the Netherlands, as well as leading the agribusiness for the EMEA. And as such, have served several clients in the food and beverages industry in the recent years. I'm passionate about the future of food and very keen to help clients make the necessary transformational steps in there. And having said that, we have a great lineup of speakers for today's webinar. The first one I would like to introduce to you is Eric Parkin. Eric is the digital business leader at Cargill. He's focused on developing new solutions to help build a smarter, safer, and more sustainable food ecosystem. And he's developing new to the world and new to the market innovation at the very intersection of food and technology. So welcome, Eric. And next, we have Divya Gautam from Unilever. Divya is the data-driven marketing leader at Unilever to achieve the digital transformation. She's focusing on embedding data-driven marketing within global brand strategy and local planning. She's overseeing end-to-end category approach to data from capturing to leveraging and performance measurement. Welcome, Divya. And next to that, we have our own Randy Jagt from Deloitte Consulting. Randy is a close colleague of mine. I work with a lot, also very much into the food space. Randy is a senior strategy partner focused on go-to-market and digital strategy and realizing these related transformations with these clients. Also, is Randy our global future of food leader, and as such, very passionate, again, also to help clients successfully drive these transformations. And let me quickly take you through the agenda for today. First, Randy will take us through the impact of COVID-19 on the future of food for the first coming 10 minutes. Then we have Eric Parkin on the keynote one, and next Divya Gautam from Unilever on keynote number two. And after that, we will open the floor for some Q&A. Which I try to moderate, and then we have a close at the top of the hour. So with that, I would like to pass on to Randy.
Thank you, Patrick, and also from my side, really excited to be here and share both on the future food, but especially on the COVID-19 impact that we see. So maybe let's start with a short video just to highlight what the future food is all about. So enjoy. Perfect. And maybe, so what we want to do with the future food, it's the transformation is absolutely happening. And we see a lot of trends and a building momentum to stress that. We see changing consumer patterns, looking for more responsible and sustainable food. We see governments setting up regulations and legislation to improve the food system. We see new ways of interacting and collaboration across an ecosystem. It's really the food transformation happening, and the momentum is now. It's clear from farmer protests, from changes that we see in the industry, a lot is happening, and the food is undergoing a massive transformation. And based on our research, but also from interacting with a lot of clients in this food space, we identified four pivotal themes that we see a lot of food companies work on. And just to highlight them one by one and quite shortly. So one is around personalized nutrition. Nutrition will get more tailored and focused to the exact personal needs that people are looking for and are in that stage of life or wanting to fulfill certain goals like running a marathon. And this is not only for people, also for animals, livestock, or even for your pets at home. We'd like to specialize and make it more personalized on what we bring to people and optimize their health, their engagement and their happiness in a way. So that's one. The second is responsible production of waste. I think very clear, if we want to feed in 2050 a population of 10 billion people, we need to take care of our environment. We need to take care of planet. So responsible production, but also waste management, where still one third of global food produced and consumed is being wasted, we need to resolve. And there's a lot of initiatives like track and traceability, waste management, better production processes and circularity taking place. The third area is Industry 4.0, the evolution of our industry, and especially the digitization of the value chain, both digital at a core, but also digital engagement with customers, suppliers, optimization of factories. There's a lot of opportunity which will help transform the food industry, and there's a lot of gain to still be realized. The fourth one is ecosystem orchestration. It's the one that connects everything together. If you really want to make an impact and make a lasting and sustainable change, you need to operate from the ecosystem and connect parties together that are possibly even outside of the value chain, including governmental bodies, life science companies, financial institutions, etc. So these are the four themes that we see as the key areas to take into account of a food transformation. So what happened when COVID had its outbreak? And let's move to the next slide. So initially we thought that actually it's just going to focus on health, but nothing was more true. We actually saw that the food system was really actively being activated and to some extent disrupted. We saw consumption being shifted even more to more organic, healthy nutrition, and actually a strong boost in alternative protein consumption. We've seen supply being strongly disrupted. Take the US, where meat plants had to be closed down, where there was shortage of certain products, there were even closing of borders for food experts or shortage of migrant workers, which impacted harvest not being being ready to be taken from the ground. It was really impacting the very intrinsic and coordinated supply chain that we come to be used of. Demand shifts were also taking place. We've seen, of course, out of home completely closing down, massive growth in the food retail space. Fortunately, finally, some restaurants are opening up again, but given that COVID will be ongoing for some time, this shift will continue to have impact. Finally, food loss. It's unbelievable the increase of food loss that's taken place. Partly because of out of home and the overstock that was still in place there, but also the panic buying of consumers to make sure that they've got enough food at home, also resulting in high food wastes and loss. And then finally, online sales boost. Where food retail grew with double digits, we saw that in certain areas, online food retail actually grew with triple digits. And there we actually saw that channel shift taking place, that food, online food retail is here to stay. A lot of new users, a lot of new people that are adopting this channel. So the key, the fundamental question is this new reality to stay, and how will it be post-COVID? So let's move to the next slide. From our perspective, the world will be different. There is a new normal taking place, and it's basically because of two things. One is COVID will not surpass quickly. We'll probably be facing the consequences of COVID or situation of COVID for the next 12 to 18 months. And so we need to get adopted to a new reality. Second, because it's clear that certain areas in our food system are not properly working, there need to be fundamental changes being made. And if we just look at some of the factors, we will increase more working and shopping from home. Online and digital will be a key channel to make use of. There will be more virtual engagement. On the other hand, people also want to meet each other. So there will still be more focus on experience or bringing people together to engage and to socialize. The supply chain will be reevaluated. And quoting the European Minister Timmermans, when we need to rebuild this house, how can we make it a more resilient but also more responsible house? And then finally, remote healthcare. Healthcare during COVID actually discovered there can be a lot being done through digital. And that will actually help to also combine them with the food and nutritional element. So imagine more digital solutions bringing food and health together. So the four areas that we see as kind of moving forward as key themes: direct to consumer, digitalized and automated operations, resilient and responsible supply chain, but also the personalized and healthy nutrition. And so moving to the next slide on how do companies cope with this? What are some of the cohorts or plays that companies are taking? And we distinguish four key ones. The first one is jump forward. It's clear the current business model is not sustainable. We need to radically shift. We need to jump forward and adopt a new business model. So imagine that you're a top European discount retailer. You need to have new partnerships with food delivery or other companies to still sell and go to market. The second is be responsible. We actually saw great signs of food companies actually, well, having a real purpose and showcasing their responsibility by taking beer, for example, back from the out of home and transforming that to sanitizing gels to support the health system. The third one is transform radically. If there were any kind of challenges in your current operation, COVID made it critically obvious you need to change. And for example, if you were over-reliant on the quick service restaurant as kind of your key channel and you didn't have a broader set, the COVID showed we need to have more broader kind of base to play in and broader, yeah, not to be too dependent on one element. And then finally, riding the wave. If you're a food retailer, you're doing great. It's every week, it's Christmas shopping. But even when riding that wave, how can you still ongoing optimize? How can you strengthen your digital capabilities, strengthen your online food retail, make sure that your supply chain is the best to ensure that your suppliers are in place to fulfill the consumer demand? So we see these four cohorts taking place. And we're actually really interested to, well, ask the audience to actually get an insight on, well, what are you doing? How are you coping with the crisis? So let's move to, we actually like to do a poll. So let's move to the next slide. So basically, we'd like to ask you on what is the main approach your company is taking to the crisis? Is that jump forward, very radical, completely change your business? Or is it be responsible, transform radically, or riding the wave? And we'd like to get your answers. Okay, let's take a look at the results. Wow, be responsible. That's the absolute key one with about 55% of answers selecting that one. And I think that makes a lot of sense, especially during these crises. There's a lot of perspective of our need to showcase, yeah, how can you make sure that your purpose showcases within these kind of moments of time. So I'm really happy to see this this response. Also interesting that riding the wave is the second one. There's still business taking place, and how can you optimize? Very interesting. Let's move to the next slide. So another question that we'd like to ask, and it's very pivotal to the presentation and webinar that we have today. Are digitization and innovation a priority for your company in the near term to ensure thriving beyond the crisis? So is it yes, we already invested? Is it yes, it's a top three priority? Or is it mixed or maybe no, not on our radar? So please submit your answers. Okay, let's take a look at the results. Ah, I love this view. It's clear, I think digital is on all companies' agendas. And it's actually great to see that already a lot got invested on the innovation and digitalization side. And in addition, if it's not there, it's definitely on the top three priority. So that's very interesting. That provides a good base on you're at the right webinar to follow. So then final poll question, because we know that innovation digitization is not easy to realize, and it can significantly help to work together with possible startups or innovation platforms. So keen to get how is this taking place, and are you as a company or people within the company adopting that? So yes, we're already doing that, or not yet, but you're going to do it, or no, not interested. So please submit your answers. Okay, can we take a look at the answers? Ah, perfect, we're already doing that. Fantastic, which is great to see, because fast-tracking kind of digitization and innovation, you need to learn from startups or work with startups to accelerate that. So it's very interesting that more than 70% is already doing that. So that's great to see. So I think these answers actually provide a perfect base to our next speaker. So Eric Parkin, love to hear from you on what you're doing within Cargill, but also what Cargill on the broader side is doing around digital and new ventures. So Eric, Please start your presentation. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Randy, and thank you everybody for having me. These numbers are very interesting to see, and I think it's so important as an industry that we continue to come together like this and share. I heard a term earlier this week. Somebody called it co-opetition, where we can cooperate with each other, but also in a way where we're understanding more about what we're doing for the future around innovation. So just as a quick intro, I have an opportunity to lead a digital business with inside Cargill, where we are developing new technology that we are bringing into the market and working with some of our partners and customers across the globe. My team's really been focused on the food side of our businesses. So we are looking at food manufacturers, food retailers, food chain restaurants, as well as food distributors. And, you know, Cargill is over 155-year-old company. We have, as Cargill, seen global crisis and pandemic throughout those years. This one has been a very swift and has created really drastic swings across the supply chain. But each of these always emphasizes that Cargill's purpose to nourish the world in a safe and responsible way becomes more important in times like this. It's really important that we are getting food to the places that we need to get it, that we are getting people to access the nutrition that they need and do that in a responsible way. And so, you know, as Cargill, we have a view across a few parts of the supply chain, and I think it's been a very differing view, as Randy's kind of highlighted. You know, we have seen on one side our retail customers facing some of the biggest logistics and supply chain problems that they have needed to solve in their history of their company. You see these empty shelves, and it's changed the way we've had to react as well and understand how to integrate our supply chain better in the future. On the flip side of that, you're seeing a very different story with our restaurant customers. You know, this is a customer who we are really trying to work with to understand what that future is going to bring and how innovation is going to help make them successful. Many of these restaurants are facing conversations where you've got independent restaurants that are going to need to close their doors for good. You have other restaurants that are trying to figure out different ways to attract customers back into their restaurant. You have QSR and fast casual restaurants who are focusing on how to drive customer intimacy through new technology channels. And so it's a very differing story across our supply chain. And it goes without saying, it's touched all of us on this call in a very different way, and it's unique to each of our businesses. Prior to COVID, Cargill, we really believe that we are standing at the beginning of a new era in food and agriculture, and the one that was going to be driven by innovation in all of its forms. But now, given this global crisis that we're facing, we see the need for technology has never been more acute. At Cargill, we're requiring that we are doing new thinking about what we need to do going forward. We're creating some unlikely partnerships. We're investing in our talent in this space, and also that we can feed the demands of our changing and very complex supply chain. And so today I want to talk about two areas that we've been focusing on as a team and things that we've been doing prior to COVID, but how that has accelerated and how that has changed through this crisis. The first is all around the supply chain. Things that we continue to have seen in the past is a supply chain that is siloed, where we are working with our partners and logistics partners and customers to try to deliver product. At the same time, we've got on the other side our restaurant operations, which we have been really focusing on how do we help them with new innovation through new product innovation, but also thinking about how we create a better consistent quality product. And so today I want to take you through these two examples and talk a little bit about what Cargill has been doing already and where we see this progressing. Before I jump into that, I think these two quotes are two that have been stick out for me and ones that we talk about as a team often. We often hear this term, the new normal, and it's a term that I think everybody is trying to figure out what that means. The reality is that we've seen that some of this is just compounding problems that we've already had as an industry, or things that we've already been working on and need to change. It's just accelerating that. And to Randy's point earlier, we're going to see this see the effects of this for the next 12 to 18 months. And this next quote on, sometime in 2021, we're going to come out of this crisis and we'll be in 2030. And what that really for us means is we need to accelerate some of those things that we were working on in early stage development, early stage design, and really start bringing those into the market and helping to accelerate us through this using technology. So let me talk a little bit about our supply chain and some of the things that we've been doing here. As I mentioned earlier, our supply chain, the food supply chain operates today in somewhat in silos. And we work together as companies to deliver products, but there are many players throughout that entire supply chain that we have to fulfill. And you see that, there's food safety risks in our supply chain, there's food waste in our supply chain, and then there's inefficiencies that are created through all of this that cause us to also spend a large amount of money that as an entire ecosystem that doesn't need to be spent. And so, when we looked at what we see today, when we think about the digital supply chain and how we can start applying technology to that, today our relationships are very point to point. The technology used today on more of the advanced end is going to be things like APIs and EDI that are all ways to exchange data between companies. But again, very static, very point to point. The reality is most of our companies are exchanging information through more manual channels, phone calls, emails, spreadsheets, really using that back and forth of we hear the term often internally of like, let me check my system, right? And that really is a way to explain that we aren't able to share that data very well today. And so Cargill has been investing over the last 9 months into a more open source distributed platform and how we can think about distributing the data amongst our supply chain. If we think about that supply chain, it's not point to point. As I mentioned earlier, there is a long string of individuals that are involved in that supply chain. And the reality is it's not just a linear supply chain either, it's actually a network. And very similar to our personal lives and how we interact with network technology and how we share information across our personal lives, these types of things are starting to pick up steam in the more business-to-business relationships that we all have created. And so, you know, for us, we see it's really important that we start investing in technology together as an industry, and it's open source, and that it's actually bringing together our supply chain more in a networked way. And so for us, it's you know, our vision is to, again, use open source technology. This is not technology that we think Cargill should own or a you know, large technology provider should own, but instead it's an open source solution where we can create a suite of business-to-business applications, which I'll talk about in a minute, and create that private secure network to connect the supply chain. And we want to do this ultimately because we see that there's obviously a big push for reasons around transparency and visibility into the supply chain. But it's also about, if we could have this information, the things that we could have changed during the early stages of COVID with you know, restaurants not needing supply and needing to move that to different parts of the supply chain, to you know, retail stores being out of product and how do we get product there faster. If we could, if our data was moving more fluidly and more openly between our supply chains, we could have reduced the time that we see would come out of, you know, what we saw during the early stages of COVID. So we've been developing different applications, as I mentioned, for use cases towards this. We are in early stages partnering with companies all over the world where we see an opportunity to actually create different types of ways for us to share information. These are examples of apps that we have been working on or piloting. You know, we see ways for us, how can we do more collaborative forecasting across our industry? How can we do, you know, ways where we are doing audit management and spec quality management on food products at all steps in the supply chain and sharing that visibility in a more open and transparent way? We do see that, you know, the needs as we do this is to still continue to create those private and secure networks. But to do this, we see that it's going to require not just Cargill doing this, but our customers, our logistics partners, and even our competitors involved in this in a way where we can actually work together. Because in the end, you know, our customers, our partners don't want to have 10 different solutions because they have 10 suppliers. We want to be using a more common solution that's interoperable between our companies that allows us to share that data. And so this has been something that, as I mentioned, we've been investing in, and Cargill has been spending time in as an industry and helping to create awareness on the work that we're doing. You saw earlier in my slides, there's links out to the technology sites that explain what we're doing, and happy to, you know, take questions on this in the Q&A. But I think it's really important that more than ever, it requires us all to come together, and it requires us to create more collaboration in the supply chain. A second place that Cargill then has been investing in, as we think about this, is really with our restaurants and the customers that we serve in the restaurant industry. As I mentioned earlier, the impact has been extreme for these customers. And I think coming out of this, we see that ensuring a consistent quality product and food safety will continue to be a priority of that kitchen of the future. For us, what we see is you know, our restaurants are really trying to focus on how to create that intimacy between their customer, the consumer. They're putting investments into the front of house of restaurant. They're investing into you know, new apps that allow the users to order online, to require delivery. And that's requiring a lot of investment on their side and time to do that. Where we see then, how can we help with the knowledge that Cargill has is understanding how that food product should be prepared. How do we need to ensure that back of house of the restaurant is really understanding you know, how to create a quality product that's safe, that's reliable, and that people can see is ultimately trying to drive a better experience for the consumer. And so, you know, we see how can we start helping with creating technology in the restaurant and partnering with the data that Cargill has on the food science side. So how has that oil been made? What specs has that been made to? How has that hamburger been developed for this specific customer? And how can we actually use technology to help those workers in the back of restaurant to really focus on that quality and safety of the product and help get that out the door as to their customers or to the delivery driver as soon as possible. And so we've been looking at how we are investing into this type of technology, creating unique partnerships in this space with companies across the globe, and how we can continue to use the knowledge Cargill has on the food science and food safety side, but then also partner that with how we can help with the operations of our partners in the restaurant. You know, this ultimately, as I said, really helps us with ways that we can help save time for our customers in the restaurant. It's using different automation, preventing food waste in a time when that is going to be extremely important, that we're purposeful about our supply chain. And you know, for kind of a post-COVID world, we see that these, you know, understanding technology in the kitchen in the future will be important to ensure safety. We need to be able to show consumers and give confidence that there are measures being taken in the restaurant to help continue to create a good product, but do it in a safe and responsible way. And so investments here for us are going to continue to be important. So as Cargill, I really, you know, I think this has been a two spaces where I wanted to share with this audience on where we have been working. These are things, as I mentioned, that are really have been compounded because of COVID, but it's also a way for us to help start partnering across the partners that we already have and new partners that are going to be coming out of this. And so for those that are, you know, attending this and, you know, this virtual part, it's always tough to not be able to stare out into the audience and create connections afterwards. You know, I really welcome, you know, to connect after sessions like this, for our companies to be partnering. There are ideas that you all have that are really important to thinking about how we can bring this to life. And so we don't see it as Cargill will solve this, but instead it's going to be how we solve this together. Thank you, and I appreciate the time. This has been a fun opportunity to test the virtual environment of doing this, so I appreciate going through these topics. I'm going to turn it over now to Divya, who is from Unilever, and she's going to take you through some of the work that Unilever is doing. Thank you.
Thanks, Eric. Hi. Hello, everyone. My name is Divya, and thank you for having me here. I am part of Foods Digital Transformation team in Unilever, and I lead data-driven marketing. What does it actually mean is I just do everything which is around consumer journey, which is around the new ways to connect with consumer, the new ways to interact with them, the new ways to identify and solve consumer problems, and the new ways to identify what is the next trend in the journey as well. The focus for today is around what is the role of digital and innovation that we see in future of food, and especially in the kind of environment we are in today. Let me start with a very powerful statement from my CEO, Ellen Yeo, and I'll read it loud because that's really close to my heart. It's like the DNA of the organization that I work with. So he is always talking about purpose. Unilever is a company which is all about purpose. And it's a very powerful statement where he says, it is not about putting purpose ahead of profits. It is purpose that drives profits. And this is something which we have really seen in the journey that we are in Unilever. All the purpose-driven brands, all the sustainable living brands are outperforming. They are delivering more impact and more growth in that manner. So this is something which is enrooted to what we do, how we do in the organization. And it is just not about the organization itself. It is also about our brands. Unilever is a big company. We have more than 300 brands, and we are present worldwide. And this is something which is really close to everything we do. We are a company of a purpose. We have brands which are full of purpose, and every person in Unilever has a purpose. I have a purpose to create value in everything I do, to create and collaborate with people, with the partners, and create something which is focusing on creating value from consumer lens perspective. And before we jump into this section for today, I would like to share with you a glimpse of how Unilever, the biggest food brand known, which is consumed by 3.5 billion times a year, over 90 countries, is putting the purpose live and into reality. So allow me to share the video with you. Isn't it beautiful? Knorr is something which is really close to my heart as well as a brand. The kind of focus we have, reinvent the food for humanity. So the focus is around how do we ensure people eat healthy, not just for themselves, but also which is healthy for the environment. So good for me and good for the planet. And this is a purpose which is thought through, and it is not just now. Even the founder of the brand in 1838 was talking about creating a brand which serves nutritious, sustainable food for humanity. So let me start with that, because this is the biggest brand in foods brand in Unilever. And now I would like to deep dive into what are the top five trends we see in, and what's the future normal look like. So we have seen in the sessions before me that the COVID or the current situations have changed a lot. But we are also working towards an era where digital transformation is accelerated to a higher speed. So what is that future normal looks like in terms of the foods that we eat or in terms of how we order it? So let me share some five key trends which are very specific for the areas that we focus in Unilever from marketing perspective as well, and the areas that we see are changing from consumer lens perspective. I think the biggest area which Patrick and Randy also talked about is around health and well-being. So we have seen with the situation we are into, and even before that, people are becoming more conscious of what do they eat, how does personalized health and well-being look alike. And it is just not about the food we eat, it's also about how mentally well-being we are, how mentally active we are, what kind of mindfulness we do. And with this current situation, we have seen huge rise in eating healthy, in eating what is meant for me, in identifying ways to improve my immunity, immunity boosters. We have also seen lots of areas where consumers are really looking to have meal, which is just not specific towards their current needs, but also to have a better shape, to have a better healthy, and to have a better, not even immunity, but also strength to carry on. And personalized health and wellness has become a biggest trend going forward as well. And we in Unilever, with one of our biggest brands, are working towards helping our consumer to have personalized meal plans. And personalized meal plans, these are based on the consumer choices, consumer preferences. And this is one of the pilots we are doing in UK. You can go and test as well, and I'm happy to receive the feedback also. So as a consumer, I can log in and share these are my preferences, these are my dietary allergens as well. So we are helping consumers to eat healthy. And as a consumer, it's also really important that how my nutrition score look like. So what is the nutrition or the calorie counter I have? Based on different recommendation engines, we also are helping consumer to swipe or to swap the ingredients at home, to also look into what is, how can they use some other ingredients to make the same recipe. So tips and tricks. And from convenience perspective, we are also encouraging consumers to buy on just a click of the button. So I think the personalized meal plan is one of the initiatives. We have seen similar initiative in most of our markets around Ramadan. We have seen in Turkey where we help consumers to eat, to have a personalized meal plan during different days. In South Africa, we ran for senior citizens some programs where we help them to do eat healthy programs and order online as well, which is around personalized nutrition. The second biggest trend which we see is around e-everything. So when I say e-everything, for me, it is like life in the current context is a life that is lit online. Out of necessity, more consumers are spending more time online, connecting, communicating, working, informing each other, educating, and then entertaining themselves. And also shopping. So I think shopping has become a biggest trend in terms of home deliveries, in terms of there is no out of home, so how could you deliver from the restaurants at home? And this is the major trend, which is likely to be a one-way permanent shift, as consumer expectations have become like instant and like digitally convenient. So on demand, instant, everything delivered at home. This is the trend which I personally believe has helped the food brands and food retail really step up in the areas that we are. And if you look at the business implication, it is very clear. The brands and the retailers will need to fast track and we need to accelerate further in our digital transformation efforts. Because the consumers who were not online or who were not connected online before has gotten entry now. And to recruit them, to sustain them, this is the biggest area. And I think the focus, if you look at from the foods perspective, that the focus we have now on grocery delivery services was never there as much as it is now. With the influence of social distancing, the contactless culture has become prevalent. We have also seen in developing markets, vending machines, e-vending machines has become a biggest culture. So I think e-everything is something which is really running on adrenaline. And it is not about just the retaining users, but it's also about opportunity to recruit new users in that space. The third trend which we have seen is about local produce. So, I personally would like to quote this, and it's a very great statement that I tell myself always, necessity is the mother of invention. And within this situation, we have seen lots of entrepreneurs coming up with great ideas in terms of how do you sell directly from farmers to consumer, because consumer perception has changed over a period of time. They are looking for quality. They are looking for the local produce to help sometimes the farmers or to think that it is more quality driven. So these are the areas which we see are also shaping up and accelerating further. The fourth area, which is really huge, is in terms of media consumption. So all of us would personally agree the amount of consumption in internet or let's say in the media channels has increased dramatically. So more than 40% of increased consumption in streaming services as compared to out of home. So there is a huge shift in media because families are spending more time at home. So there is a huge opportunity to play a role or to connect with consumers in those channels, in streaming videos, Netflix. So there are regional players like Hotstar in India, which has more than 300 million subscribers. And Disney had more than 50 million subscribers in just 5 months. So there is a huge opportunity there. Within Unilever, in most of our countries also, we also work with lots of influencers. And to have those kinds of sessions, master lessons, master cooking session, where we are connecting with consumers to make that recipe at home, to help them engage with our brands, to help them eat healthy, to build their immunity, to help them with quick recipes for lunch, to connect, create a family moment during the holidays or the weekend. So we have run all those programs as Unilever as well. So I think this is one of the area where this trend would also continue because in-home consumption is increasing more than 40%. So this is a really like a great opportunity for different players to come and play into. The another area, and this is not a, like a positive, I will say it's like a watch out for all of us. We have seen lots of challenges in financial situations. So the capacity to go out could be a challenge for few of the people financially as well. So this is a great opportunity where, personally, I would love to drive some things. How do we bring that amazing restaurant experience from out of home to my in-home? How could we replicate the Michelin star recipes and bring that to consumer at the doorstep, you know? And then what are the areas we could do? We could leverage with the combination of in-home media or with the combination of direct to consumer or delivery channels. So this is also one of the area. The topmost area, but I put it at the end because I would like to summarize it very nicely, is the cocooning part of it. So when I say cocooning, this is the biggest thing which we have seen in the last, the entire last couple of months. So with the acceleration of global experimentations at home, we all have been experimenting with what we cook, how do we cook, what do we eat, and the rise of the virtual Zoom sessions, the drinks and the videos, work from home day, the isolation stay, the home cooking, the baking with the kids, or even virtual travel and tourism. This, the home cocooning has given a great opportunity for all of us to experiment new ways to eat. And scratch cooking has become a great part in that area. And with the kind of food brands we have, we are really helping consumers not only to have the scratch cooking and make the delicious meal and have those recipes and tips and tricks, but also we have another big brand, Hellmann's, whose brand purpose is about less waste and help consumers to reduce food waste. So I think I would really love to end my presentation with a great video from Hellmann's, where we inspire consumers to leverage the ingredients at home and do a really good and healthy lifestyle. So allow me to share that with you. I think I would really like to end with that. This is from our Hellmann's family to your family, to stay at home and do a healthy cooking and enjoy all the recipes that we can offer you to stay at home. Thank you.
Thank you, Divya, and also Eric and Randy for your participation and your very interesting keynotes. This is the time, I think, to open up for Q&A. We might not have mentioned it in the start of the webinar, but you are able to post your questions in the screen. And we would, once again, like to invite you to do so. So if you have any questions or comments to one of the speakers or more in general to anyone else, please post your questions. We have some questions already in. So while giving you the time to actually post your questions, you can, let's start already with raising some. So one was like, many thanks for the informative webinar, very impressed. But the question actually is, how are Cargill and Unilever working with certification and labeling, especially in the view of sustainability strategy and carbon footprint? Are there digital innovations on this side as well, either ongoing or planned for post-COVID time? So Eric or Divya, yeah, would you handle that?
Yep. So I can go first, and Divya, I think welcome your inputs as well after. But so as Cargill, obviously, you know, is called out in our mission, you know, nourishing the world in a safe and responsible way is a big part of this. There are things that we are doing today across the different products that we supply, whether that's in palm, whether that's in cocoa, soy, different areas where we are starting to use technology to create transparency across this this ecosystem. You know, I think that we often talk about is, you know, how can we continue to help tell that story, but more importantly, how can we create visibility into the supply chain? So we've been working on some different technologies and starting to work with our customers and helping to answer questions with them, but then building out a platform. And so when we talk about some of those different apps that I showed in the picture, one of those apps is actually all around how can we talk through the different transparency in the supply chain. And so how does our customers, so this is, you know, going to be CPG companies, this is gonna, like the Unilevers, this is gonna be around restaurants, this is gonna be around retailers, and being able to help get that information through the supply chain and to them to continue to help tell that story as well. And so we are in the early stages of developing a couple different solutions around palm, soy, cocoa, and others. So that's been, I think, a big focus for us and how we are starting to use technology to do that in a more distributed way.
Yeah, great, Eric. Thanks. I think you call it food with a story, right? So,
yeah, that's good. Correct.
Divya, any from your perspective on this one?
So I think from Unilever point of view, sustainability improvements is a really, really critical and big focus area for us also. Not now, but before as well. So we have done a couple of great projects for brands like Lipton, for tea leaves. We have done great pilots in some Southeast Asian markets for Coke, for to drive provenance and other things. So I think there are lots of things which we are already driving, and we need to scale it more that it becomes business as usual. So it's a big focus for us, if that answers your question.
I assume it does, so thank you very much. So another question for you, Divya, from the public is the trend of local produce, as you mentioned during your presentation, is mainly driven by consumers and or also by supply chain problems. So is the trend of local produce?
It's both. Yeah, I think it's a combination of both, but it also depends the region as well. So in most of the European, we did not have as much challenges in delivery as we have seen in, for example, in India or South Africa, where the complete lockdown is there. So there's a combination of both. It depends on the consumer needs and delivery challenges as well. But we have seen amazing entrepreneur ideas, which is just coming out of starting something which could have a delivery challenge, but it is a really killing consumer insights.
Thank you, Divya. And another question, rather interesting, is do you think personal nutrition will hit the mass market, so to speak, in a post-COVID world? And if so, how soon? So what is your opinion on that, Eric, Divya?
So I think I can take personalized nutrition because it's very close to my heart. I want to do that for last 1 year, but I think timings were not right at the time. So the appetite is there, but if we say it will be mass, I'm not sure about that. Personalization is, it depends on what do we call it as personalization. Personalization is a word which is being used, in many different ways. So it could be a segment, a group of segments, and catering to that need of segment could also be a personalized services. When we go a level above, it could be at a family level. So familiarization, I normally call it. So sending a meal or sending a personalized nutrition towards a family area is also personalization. The top layer is individualization. So when I know this is my gut health or this is my DNA and this is something which I should eat, which I should not eat, that's individualization. So to reach the individualization, I'm not sure the industry or everyone is ready yet, or if there is an appetite also. But on segmentation level, mass personalization level, and to an extent of customization, I think it would be booming next in a couple of years. That's my personal point of view.
Yeah, just to add on from a Cargill perspective, you know, this is a nutrition is a continued investment. Just there was an announcement made yesterday publicly. Cargill has created a partnership with Eagle Genomics, focusing on gut biome. We see that, you know, really starting to understand this data better and understand the information that connects, you know, healthy humans, healthy animals, healthy plants, and healthy planet ultimately are going to be interconnected. And so, you know, I think for us, we're starting to make those investments and understanding on how our portion of the supply chain plays a role in feeding information to the Unilevers and to other companies who have the consumer-facing brands. And so, you know, that's where I think Cargill has been making the investments. I think we will continue to work with consumer brand companies to understand that timing. I think it's really going to be an important understanding of how that quickly accelerates, and what information is needed for companies to feel comfortable. The last point I'd make is, I think, and Divya called this out, and I think Randy in the beginning, is it's going to require some unlikely partnerships in the food industry on the health side as well. And so, you know, really understanding the medical industry and that field and bringing it together is going to be something that needs to happen before I think we really start to see a mass adoption.
Just to build on that, pure personalized nutrition will probably still take quite some time before that takes in place and have the data and have the tracking mechanisms to really measure the impact on food, on a personal body, etc. However, with the increase of digitization during COVID, and as well as the link between food and health, I do think that that trend will accelerate and there will be more opportunity to leverage those kind of solutions, insights, data, perspective, and leverage food as part of preemptive care, but also post care, will really fast track this development. So it's definitely an interesting area to watch out for.
Okay, thank you very much. It's already 4 o'clock, so at the top of the hour, at least 4 o'clock European time for the people coming from other countries. I think it's a good time to wrap. And thank you all for your participation, and especially the keynote speaker. So Eric, Divya, and Randy, thank you very much for your time and your interesting perspectives on this theme today. I want to thank the audience once again for your participation and the interactions and some of the questions. We could not answer them all, but let's save them for another moment, hopefully, when we're going to interact on this very interesting topic of the future of food. Once again, thank you very much, and wish you all a great day. Bye.